Alright, hello everyone. Doing a video on my DR650SE here today. This is a dual sport made by Suzuki, if you're not familiar with it. And this is the 1997 model. This is like 2 years after they updated the DR650 design. And yep, so let's get to it. So yeah, this is a highly accessorized DR650. For dual sport touring, I guess. I used to have what they call a classic DR, and it was a 91 model. Yeah, I went to all black DR, and now I got pretty much all white DR, from black to white. Yeah, actually these handguards are from my old DR, that's why they're still black underneath, but I have spoilers on the front, and they're the Tusk brand. What else? But it was a kick start, so after I broke my foot on it, I had to get an electric start, and well, why not get the newer DR? The newer DR is an updated design on the old one. The newer one has an aluminum swing arm right here. So it's a little lighter, and the engine is a little more compact than the old one. It actually doesn't produce as much power as the older one. I think the fork design is updated too. Still a steel frame. So let's see. There it is. So yeah, if you've been wondering what I've been riding on most of my videos and what I got installed on this guy. Well, before I start getting into the mods too much, let me talk about the history of this bike. I bought this off of a dude in Prunedale. Yes, Prunedale. That's it's just past Gilroy a little bit. And when I got it, it had the rear fender here was all burnt up. I don't know why. They said a jacket caught on fire on it. Like, good thing it didn't burn the rest of the bike. But yeah, the rear was all burnt up. So I bought a new one, or a new used one. Had an Edelbrock carb on it. The rear shock was actually blown, like, completely. I've never ridden a bike with a super blown out shock. I've ridden ones where they were like nearly out of oil, but this one was completely out of oil, and it was just dangerous. It would just flop around all over the place. So I replaced that with a new used one I got on eBay. What else? What else did it come with? Did they come with that tank stock? It came with those bar stock. Well, I mean, when I first bought it, I think, and it had a super trap muffler that I talked about, and it came with the stock trail wings. These are not the stock tires. Let me go with what I had on the bike. All right, so it came with this bigger tank, and it was I think the stock tank is about two, maybe around 3 gallons. It's too small. The older DR actually had a 5-gallon tank stock, so I don't know. They kind of like downgraded it. They wanted to make it more dirt bike-ish, I guess. And I guess that makes sense. I had to change the cap on it. These gas caps are garbage on the IMS. I think they updated the. What happened is that the gasket it disintegrated. That's what happened. Same thing happened to my dad's bike. My dad's bike has the same tank. And yeah, I guess they're saying that the ethanol and the gasoline now, I think are running E10 right now. It had disintegrated the seals faster. So this is actually a Acerbis gas cap, and it's locking, so that's a bonus. I don't really lock it all that much, unless I'm parking it in some kind of shady place where I think someone's gonna steal my gas. But these bars came with it. These aren't the stock bars. The stock bars are steel. I'm not really sure what brand these are. They might be a rental. Oh, and speaking of the carb, actually, this bike did not come with the stock carb. The what was it? The BS40. This came with Edelbrock. Came with a Edelbrock carb, an American carb, and it was a slide carb. But I had a bunch of problems with it, and there wasn't like a lot of support for it. I guess they weren't making it anymore. But the YFC carb is the best. So I went from the Edelbrock to the stock carb. I didn't like that. It was okay. It had some good punch to it after I rejetted it. But this one, I like this one better. It just runs better. You know. So yeah. And then it did come with it did come with a Super Trap exhaust, but I changed it to this Gixxer 750 muffler. This is a Gixxer 750 muffler. I call it a 35FO, 35F0, whatever. And it has an FMF spark arrestor on it at the end of it to make it to allow you to ride it off road on trails. It's a big muffler. It's much longer than the Super Trap. I never had the stock muffler, so but I do have a stock muffler with me, but I never installed it. It's supposed to be lighter and flow better. And yeah, so it has a custom mid pipe. Unfortunately, when the swing arm moves too much, it actually hits the brake line. So that's why I got this piece of aluminum foil here, so it doesn't burn through the brake line. I don't think it'll be too much of a problem. Maybe I'll have to relocate it on the side sometime. I don't know, or bend it somehow. But it works good. What's good about this is it flows better than the stock muffler. It's not like the 40FO, the Gixxer 1000. I mean, it is, but it isn't. It's not made out of titanium like that one. So supposedly that's like the holy grail of of a muffler sort of DR. But this one is nice. It's quiet. It flows better than stock. And it's not a whole really loud. In fact, the intake is actually louder on this bike than the exhaust. So I don't like it too loud, but I don't like it too quiet either. It's just right. I actually managed to do the header weld mod. So supposedly, if you take the head pipe off, there's a big ugly weld where the flange is, and you grind that down as much as possible. It's different on different bikes. This one didn't seem too bad. It's not as bad as I've seen as some other ones on the internet. What other power mods do I have? I think that's about it for the power department. I am running a 14.2 sprocket. I like to switch between 14 and 15. I think if I was going to do a lot of freeway, I would go back to the 15. But overall, 14 is not bad. And I like to have that engine braking power when going off-road. I'm not big on the brakes. What else? So right now, let's see, where should I start? Let's start with the power plant. So the power plant, really the only upgrades that I've done on it, well, the biggest upgrade is a Yamaha FCR39MX carb. And that's the biggest mod. I had a lot of problem with surging on this before. I think supposedly if you have a stock DR, it's not much of a problem, but at about the 65 mile per hour speed, And anything over like 55, it would surge. It would kind of feel like it won't doesn't want to maintain a cruising speed. It like slows up, speed down, slows up, speed down. It doesn't feel like it don't want to go anymore. So that's why I installed this, and I think that's the biggest upgrade. They say you can run at lower RPMs and stuff. I don't really notice that difference, but yeah, I never really rode it off road with the old car all that much, so I really can't compare too much. But it's a lot of work getting it in there. It's not really designed for this bike, but it fits well if after you modify it. It came I don't know, it's not really the power plant, but it came with this IMS tank. I think this is it's almost like a 5 gallon tank, so it's pretty beefy. It's the white colored tank. The natural color one, the see-through one, is kind of like it's kind of whitish color, but it's not. This is the white one. You can't really see the gas in it, unfortunately. But fuel consumption and range. I never had the stock tank. I don't know how many miles you can get on a stock tank. I get about 250 miles to the tank on this. 250, 240, 250, somewhere around that area, depending on how much I'm doing this, you know. Well, actually, I found out. I don't know. It's one of my bikes. One of my bikes is like the harder I ride it, the better gas mileage it gets. It's odd, but I don't know if it's this bike or not. I got too many damn bikes. But yeah, I get about 240 to 250 miles before maybe I'll have to hit the reserve. I don't think I've ever hit the reserve on this. I always fill up before then. Fuel consumption is 45 miles per gallon. I like to track my gas mileage on all my vehicles and my bikes. This gets 45 miles per gallon. A stock DR will probably get you, I would say, 50 average. And if you were to find a range, I would say 45 to maybe like 55 miles per gallon. Before the carb, I used to get 50 miles per gallon. Maybe I'm too rich on this. Maybe. I don't know. I have a gutted airbox. The airbox has like holes all over it, so it's just loud as hell. I've gotten used to it, but going uphill, it is loud as hell. And you're just like when you're under load and you're going uphill, it is really loud. But other than that, it's okay. With the mods I got on it, I think I may be a little bit rich. I get average 45 miles per gallon every tank, so that's pretty damn good gas mileage. Pretty damn good. Not the most aerodynamic bike, and it's got like quite a few accessories on it. But yeah, it's awesome. Oh, another power mod is I have an uni filter. You probably can't see it, but it's in there somewhere. It's red and it's foamy. And it flows more air. So, like a tires. Let's talk about tires. Right now I'm running a Kenda 270 tire. These are actually from my old DR, and they are just about done. I'm actually gonna change them out for some not Shinko 700s. I absolutely love these tires. I went with a different tire this time so I could experiment. These are a 50/50 tire, and I actually found out they're like a kind of like a trials tire. I heard they're really good on like really hard packed stuff, like rocks and stuff. If you air them down a lot, they're really good off road, and they're decent off road too. You can lean them quite a bit. When you lean it to about here, though, you can feel the knobs flex, and it's just scary. But I've gotten a lot of lean on these before. The front, I just changed. I used to have a Kenda 270. It kind of wore out, so I'm trying out these Michelin T63s. I heard a lot of good things about them. This looks like a straight up knobby tire. This is for some serious off-road action. I think this is a 50/50 also. Doesn't look it. I didn't go with the rear, but I don't like the front Kenda 750 270. When they wear out, they just get scary, you know. The back I absolutely love. I might go if the 700s don't work out well for me, then I'm going back to the 270. They're cheap too. What else? All right, so I also have a SW Motec center stand. So if I ever need to change my tires off-road, man, this thing's only like a month old and looks like it's been on there for quite some time. There's like oil all over. I got some weird oil leak on mine. But yeah, if I want to change tires off-road, I don't want to use some funky trail stand. The center stand is great. I don't need a special. I don't need a jack stand or a jack to jack up the bike if I want to work on it. It's awesome. I highly recommend getting a bike with a center stand or a center stand for your bike. They make one. This one not the easiest to put up on the center stand, especially since mine is lowered. Oh yeah, we'll get to that too. But yeah, you kind of have to like pick it up a little bit. And good thing I have these luggage racks here. I use this to pick it up. Normally you'd use this. With it weighed down, it's kind of hard to get up there. Oh, there that goes. So yes, it is lowered. It's lowered a little bit. I'm stock. The bike fits me pretty good. But the good thing about the DR from the factory, they give you options to lower it. So if you're like a high challenge person, this might be a good bike for you if you're looking for a dual sport. But there's a second hole in the shock. I don't know if there. Yeah, you can see it. See, there's an extra hole right somewhere. Yeah. There's a hole on the bottom there. Oh, there we go. Point to it right there. So you can see there's an extra hole. It's on the topmost hole. That means it lowers it maybe like an inch, maybe. But I have lowered it, but the preload is set up pretty kind of high. Yeah, I guess since we're on the topic of suspension, let's talk about suspension. I've got a. Oh, I don't remember what. I got this from Pro Cycle. It's one of those Pro Cycle springs. It's not the stock spring. It's the middleweight spring, I think. I think it's the middleweight spring. It's not the really heavy spring, but I can definitely feel when this bike is loaded down, it still needs more. The stock suspension just sucks on this bike. Everyone's saying that you need to upgrade it. But yeah, this is a slightly stiffer spring, and I have some beefier fork springs inside this bike. It is the middleweight spring, I think. It's not the totally stiff one, and it's okay. I don't really notice much of a difference. It does feel stiffer, but I think just changing the fork oil on this made a big difference. So you'll be surprised how much different your bike corners when you got fresh fork oil and the proper fork oil level, you know. And another thing is that I pushed the fork tubes up about an inch to compensate for that lowered back. And S actually has a factory lowered side stand too. So I like to be able to have my feet on the ground. It gives me more confidence off road, you know. Suspension. Oh, I think that's about it for the suspension department. It's just got beefier springs, and I like it. I think it could be better, but it does me good for what I need it. Let's talk about luggage. So I got quite a bit of luggage on this because I use this for dual sport touring. So. Start with the barbecue rack. So I got this barbecue rack. It's one of the last ones I found on eBay. I think there's still some people that do make them like this, but it's not the original. I think this is one of the original barbecue racks, and it attaches to your grab handlebars. But it's really wide. That's what I like about it. So if you do drop the bike, it protects your turn signals. Your turn signals don't get all banged up, and it lands on the rack. So that's good. And I do have shorter turn signals. These are some cheap eBay ones. They're not LED ones though. Same with the front. But I like them. They look good. And they're shorter, so they'll get broken less, and if you go off, you know. I got this B stem T box. This is actually on my 750 Turbo, but I'm not riding it right now, so I just use this one. Supposedly, you can put two full-size helmets in this bad boy, but just my one just my one dual sport helmet fits in there. But it's lockable, that's what I like about it, and you can take it off. When I ride off-road, okay, yeah, so I can take it off. When I ride off-road, if I do some kind of off-road with luggage, I like to use a duffel bag. And for that, I have the Wolfman duffel, the dry duffel. Because when you're going off-road, you don't want stuff to flop around and stuff. And you can tie a duffel bag down so it doesn't do that. So if I was to do a lot of street touring, I would probably take this with me. This holds like a good amount of stuff. What else? Yeah, you can see the straps. These are the straps for the Wolfman duffel bag. I got these side pannier holders. These are this is the full dealie right here. It has the support in the back and everything, so it can hold like hard bags. But I have these mechanic bag dealies. They're large mechanic bags, kind of like what the military uses. And I pull them together with these Harbor Freight straps, and it's like put on together by this using this. It's a cutting board I used, but you can just use some nylon stuff you find at Tap Plastics. And it works good. I've taken them off road. They're not totally waterproof. That's my little gripe about it. I'm sure if you could put some kind of plastic bag around it, should be no problem though. So what I'll normally do is I'll put all my camping stuff in the duffel bag. So when I get to a campsite, I just pull everything out of the duffel bag, and then that's my campsite. And if I need to get to anything quickly, I'll put it in here, like a jacket or water or something like that. Because the duffel bag, you kind of have to like pack from top to bottom. So yeah, I have a video on how I built these and I put them on. They're $20 a bag. These ones are getting kind of old, with just some fabric spray paint, and they look brand new. They have them different colors too. They have like camouflage ones and stuff. I just got the black ones. Yeah, you can see I got kind of that black and white theme going. So. And speaking of these racks, I got these on eBay. There's a Canadian seller that makes these, and they make them not painted. So you can save money, they don't paint them. So you paint them whatever color you want. And these have a black, and I think they're primered with the, and then I sprayed them with a black engine enamel, I think, maybe. I can't remember. And then I did a final top coat with Plasti Dip. That the Plasti Dip comes off, because you can see it's peeling off already. So I may just go back with the engine enamel. Also, speaking of paint, this frame, this used to be a white, yellow, and purple DR. It's because you can see the frame is purple. This is the most horrendous color DR ever. You know, that's why. Anyway, I'm glad they spray painted it black. You can see the paint coming off underneath it, but yeah, the newer model DRs, I'm not sure how many of them, but have a kind of gunmetal color, like kind of like the grab handlebar here. You see that? And I like that color a lot. It's about almost the same color as the engine. I like that. The black is okay, I guess, but I like that gunmetal color better. Luggage. Oh, I have these this tank panniers. It's kind of hard to find a good tank bag for the DR650 just because of its design. Seat goes up here. There's really not much, you know, else that you can flop on there. But these are actually ATV fender packs, and I got this for $30. And I just went to Walmart and I got these little quick releases here. So if I want to take the tank off, I just pop this off, pop the next one off, and I just throw it off the other side, and I could take the tank off really easy if I need to service it. I've taken the tank off on this too many times. You know, I do a lot of work on my bike. And here it's just tied with a double D loop, double D ring loop tie downs. To the radiator guard, or oil cooler guard. It's not a radiator, but it does. What other? So what I'll normally put on here is like just stuff I need to get to right away, like sunglasses, flashlight, batteries, camera. I like to put water bottles. If I go down, I want it to go on something like soft. So I'll put like a jacket. Or water bottle. So if I I won't break it, you know. I won't feel bad if I break it. Okay. It also pad the landing. So they do kind of act like a crash bar too. So I try not to put anything fragile in these, because it's kind of your tank protector too. So looks good. And that's about it for luggage. I have let's go to controls. For controls, I have this TrailTech Vapor here. This is the stealth version, the black one. And honestly, after using this for so long, I don't even use this anymore. I wanted to make it so I could keep the stock one too, but honestly, I just use this one and it's great. Like, honestly, you don't even really pay attention to the RPM all that much unless you're like cruising. So I think just the TrailTech is fine. Or even just a bicycle computer, but this is great because at night it has a backlight, so you can use it. And controls. I got some rally gel grips. I actually don't like these. These are kind of too thick for my hands, and I don't think I have the longest hands in the world. They're heated. I have a heated grips kit. It has a high and low mode right here. Actually uses bracket to brace my TrailTech too, so it's nice and stiff. The TrailTech comes with this handlebar mount. It comes with this handlebar mount, and it only has like a one. It's like a one. It only clamps your handlebars on one side. So I built this support for it, and it goes to the other side. Screw bolts onto the other side of it, so it's nice and stiff. Because to reset it, you gotta hit these two buttons here, and then if you press it, and it only has this one side, it starts flexing and it's hard to press, you know. I feel like you're gonna break it. Controls. I got two RAM mounts here. Normally, I will put my GPS here, and like a cell phone mount or something. So I kind of have two forms of GPS. I have these. I'm not sure what brand these are. I think these are. I think they're the Kenshan folding mirrors, or a bottom, or they're like an Emco brand. But these actually have a pivoting ball on it, where they install. Let's get this boot off. There we go. Yeah, so actually pivots there. So if you fall, it won't break the mirror. It'll push them in, you know. Or you can fold them in if you go off road, but. But these are like kind of notorious for like the wind pushing them back, and you know, I kind of don't like them. I may go with something else if I ever break these. In fact, just I never broken the mirror before. I've gone down many times with these, and I've actually that one day the mirror just fell off. The mirror part, it just fell off for no reason, no reason at all. So I went and put these what's this? It's a convex mirror. I think it's like a 3 point something inch convex mirror, and actually works better than the stock mirror, and I don't have to worry about falling it off because it's double-sided taped on there, so I guess it adds some little vibration dampening too to it. But it's still kind of hard to see. Everything is smaller with this too, but the mirrors are really small on the old ones. This one still has the old mirror in the back. See, you can see. So I'm just waiting for this one to fall off too. I guess it hasn't fallen off yet. Brakes. So this is the brake control. Brake controls. This is actually my custom-made shorty lever. What I did is I cut the lever down. I actually wanted to go for a actually was going for a three-finger lever, but these are actually they're actually a two-finger lever. I mean, I could fit three without a glove on, but with gloves on, it's a two-finger. But I generally brake with only two hands. I know it's a bad habit. It's not what they teach you in MSF school, but like yeah, it so basically what I did is I cut the lever down, and I cut the ball off, and then there's a little hole underneath the ball, so I enlarged it a little bit, and then I just stuck it on there, and I JB welded it, so it kind of has that stock look, and it's something to stop your finger from coming off. But now you can kind of like do this number. I like it. I like it a lot. But I was going for three fingers. I'm still running the stock clutch levers. I'm happy with just the five full brake length, full clutch lever length. Speaking of brakes, I have one mod. This is actually, I took this off of my KLR250 before I sold it, but this is a Galfer braided brake line, and it makes a big difference. The brakes are much stiffer now. The little rubbers that hold this little slider thing here, they kind of wore out already. So I have this homemade, I cut a fuel hose. And I cut it in the middle, and I zip tied it there to hold it in place. They kind of rub on this, and it's kind of not like, and it wants to rub on my Trail Tech. I don't know why it's doing this S thing on it. Maybe I should have, but yeah, I got it on there. It helps. I think my pads are something's wrong. My pads are glazed over because there's not a whole bunch of power. They're not biting as much as they used to. So I think it's time to change the pads. I tried cleaning the rotors. And I don't think it's the rotors that's the problem. But yeah, that's pretty much my only brake mod. Like I mentioned earlier, I have these Tusk Bark Busters. Oh, that's one of the reasons I went with the shorter lever, because for some reason only the brake lever was touching the Bark Busters. These ones don't fit very perfectly, you know? So I cut the brake lever down. So I got these vibratinators, they call them. They're these long brass inserts that you put in here, and they're supposed to dampen the vibrations. For some reason, I did something to this bike, and it vibrates a lot now. I think it could be the worn out tires, but we'll see. I was only able to put one in because these handguards don't actually fit perfectly. These bars are too narrow. But I like them. These bars are comfortable. I also have auxiliary 12-volt power here for if I want to charge something. What I'll do is I'll use this to charge my electronics at night when I go camping. It works great. I wish I had two of them. I use it for like my airbed to charge my action camera, my phone, everything. I actually have what this is here is a second. Spare clutch cable, just in case I break a clutch cable. Trick people do is they zip tie another clutch line right next to their existing clutch line. So if you ever break the cable, you can easily install another one. That would suck, you know, if your clutch line just snapped and you're in the middle of nowhere and you have to ride without a clutch. Without a clutch, basically. I actually have I have some off-road lights that I installed last night. I got finished last night, and I'm using a Trail Tech switch here, and it's wired to the relay for my heated grip. So whenever I turn the power on, then it has power. So it works kind of like the headlights. And speaking of the headlights, let's get onto the headlights. I got a Sylvania Silver Star. It's like the highest end one. It's still not very bright, but I should probably just go with LEDs. I have this kind of like homemade headlight grill here. This is for like a pickup truck or something. I bought it. It's really cheap, like $6. Doesn't fit perfectly. I had to bend it kind of like here and here to get it to fit the headlights a little bit smaller. It's for like a square headlight. And it's a little bit too tall, but I use it to mount here. There's a screw here and two zip ties holding it. I think that should do it. Any kind of big rock, hopefully, won't get to the headlight. There's still a little bit of space in there, so hopefully, it won't be big enough to break the headlight. And I have these Cree 10-watt floodlights. These are the 30-degree flood lamps, and you shouldn't. You really shouldn't use these on the road with other people. If you're off riding in the mountains by yourself at night, and you know, you don't see anybody, you could use them like a high beam sort of, and these will illuminate the whole road. I would even just say like, hey, you could probably ride without the main headlight. It's that bright. And since we're on the front end, I got a Supermoto fender here. Helps give it some more stability on the freeway. And I got a National Cycle windscreen here. This works great. I love it. It's a bitch to adjust it though. There's so much adjustability on this thing. It clamps to your handlebars, and you can adjust the height, the angle. You can adjust the angle of the plastic, just the plastic part, and you can remove it. So what I like to do is when I do a lot of freeway riding, well, basically on the street, I ride with this. If it's getting really hot, I take it off so I can get the full wind to my chest and my head, you know. I love it, you know. And where I put it, I just I stuff it on the top of my duffel bag, and I use a net to hold it. And that's why it's kind of scratched up right now. But what I do is I'll stick it in the t-shirt or something and then put it on top so it doesn't get too scratched up. I don't really look through it anyways. But it's great. It works. I love it. What else? The controls. I think that's it on the controls. I have this little cruise control thingy, but I don't really use it too much. The bike vibrates so much that it, you know. But I've been getting really bad blisters after a long day of riding. So I think I have a cramp buster, a little lever thing that goes here, but I can't find it. I might have to buy a new one, but yeah. Good stuff. I got these big off-road pegs, but I kind of don't like them. I got really used to the stock ones. The stock ones are good. People don't like them, but I think they're just fine. I'm not used to these really big ones. They're not very sharp. These are the cheaper versions though, so that could be why. Yeah, I was expecting it to be sharper than that, but they look nice. But they're just too it's too much of a platform. I like just a peg. What else? I still got the stock passenger pegs. I like to use these to change my feet position. It kind of feels like you're riding a sport bike when they're back here, though. What else? Oh, I have, I don't have it on the bike right now, but I have an air seat. I forgot what brand it is, but it's one of those ones you inflate. It's the cheaper one, and you just put it on top of here, and I clamp it onto here. So if I want to, I want a little more comfort, I'll put it on top, you know. And if I want to slide around a little more, this seat's a little bit more slipperier. It's not super slippery though. And but the air seat is great. It, if you want more comfort, I definitely recommend an air seat. But it only gives you so much more comfort, you know. this is a sergeant seat. I think this is I'm not sure. It's a little bit dished. The stock seat is kind of like a motocross seat, and it's horrible. It's really hard and yucky. The sergeant seat is awesome. I like it a lot, and it looks cool. It's got kind of like that carbon fiber material looking. I'm not sure. I don't think this is the lowered seat. I think this is the regular height, but it is dished. So, and it's a little wider than stock. It's a great seat. You can pick them up around 200 used. I think that's how much I got this one for. And 300 brand new. Highly recommend. And they fit with the stock with the IMS tank. The Corbin doesn't. What other mod? Speaking of that, I also have risers on these for these handlebars, so they go up a little more. It's more a little more comfortable standing. For the luggage, I have these tool tubes here. This big one here has the majority of my tools in it. Come on, focus. There we go. And I riveted these wires onto here, and then they're locked by the helmet lock. And if I do want to use a helmet lock, I have this gun lock here. I just gun lock it to my rack. And that keeps you people from messing around with that stuff. This one doesn't have one. This one just has like my clutch lever, spare clutch levers and stuff. So this one has my tire spoons and stuff in it. I don't want people stealing that stuff. Yep. I have the updated Suzuki locking nut here. It's really not much of a difference, but it's cool. Don't have to carry cotter pins. Also, I'm running rim locks on the tire, on the wheels. There's one rim lock on each wheel so I can air them down so I get the maximum traction off-road. Yeah, so that's pretty much it. That's my bike. Let's give a little walk around. I'm And I like it a lot. I think the DR, the stock DR is a good, it's like a blank canvas. That's how I like to explain it. You can build it into like what you want it to do. I've done a lot of mods on this, so, you know. Oh yeah, the skid plate. This is, I think this is a moose skid plate, yeah. I bought it used. It's a good one. Something to protect the bottom. I don't think you really need it, you know, but if I needed to upgrade the engine protection, I would get those plates that reinforce the side cases. Yeah, because that would suck getting a hole in one of those. Also, my gas tank has a Raptor petcock. It's supposed to be better. And that's pretty much it. Yeah, but my take on the DR is that it's a good blank canvas. It's a cheap, reliable, easy to work on motorcycle. You can adjust the valves very easily by yourself if you have a little know-how. It's generally easy to take the bike apart. With the center stand, it makes working on the bike even that much more easier, you know. Yeah, also these fork boots are Acer Bis fork boots. These aren't stock, but they came with the bike, so. What else? Oh, I was talking about the DR650. Yeah, so, I've had two generations of DR650. I love these bikes. They're pretty smooth for a single. My gripe about this bike is it's not good on the freeways. You can ride on the freeway, but, you know, it's for, like, how long, you know? I picked up this handlebar vibration that I never had when I first had the bike. It might be jetting, it might be worn out tires, it's something, you know? I haven't figured it out, but the bike doesn't vibrate like crazy. Like, it's just the handlebars they're getting me right now. But it's a reasonably smooth single, and it's got some decent power. It's got a good lot of low-end power, you know? It's not like one of those you rev it really high, you know? But on the freeway, you're revving it pretty bad. Yeah, I wish this bike had a sixth gear. That's another gripe about this bike. It really, really, really needs a sixth gear to be a better bike, you know? And then, the stock bike, I would say the DR is good for, like, a commuter. Someone that likes to go ride the trails on the weekend. Or if you live in, like, kind of like a... Or just, like, a little off-road, like fire road sort of, or you have like a long dirt driveway, stuff like that. It's great for doing that. And for touring, you kind of have to upgrade it a little more. My bike, I would say it's like kind of in between that dual sport and adventure bike category, you know. It's light enough where you can take it pretty much any place, you know. But once it's loaded up, it's a heavy beast, you know. Yeah, so I was talking about my philosophies on the DR650, how it's a great dual sport. It's great for commuting and just doing some casual trail riding, and how the mods I've done reflect I like to use it for motorcycle touring, like adventure touring. So the bike is set up more. It's like in between the lines between a dual sport and an adventure class bike. So it's not quite the weight of a adventure bike, but it's not quite as light as most of the dual sports anymore, you know? Yeah. But it's still very much like a dirt bike. Just not the best suspension. but I can work with it. My biggest gripe is riding this thing on the freeway. I just absolutely don't like riding it on the freeway. It just vibrates more. I think, I hate to say it, but I think my next bike may be a BMW F650 or something along the lines of F800. I've ridden one, and it's just much smoother on the freeway, and it's got that 6-speed transmission, so... But for now, this will work. I'll see how far it gets me. How many miles I got on this bad boy? 8,600 miles? Not a lot. It's quite an old bike, but it don't have a lot of miles on it. It definitely has had a rough life. Whoever had it before didn't take very good care of it, and it's just a lot of like there's a lot of rust on it that it really shouldn't have for a bike of this many miles. You know, it's like it just kind of like abused it. They kept it outside for a long time. Didn't ride it, and they gave it to me, and I didn't ride it for a while too. It took me a while to get it up to where it was, to where it is right now. But you know, I love it. I love riding it. It's a great bike. It's not the most powerful bike. It's not the best handling bike. But I bet you I can keep up. I can keep up on the twisties if I put some stickier, less dirt-oriented tires on this. But hey, I still keep up on the twisties with my buddies with this. Yeah, I've gotten this to lean quite a bit, and but yeah, with all this stuff, with all the luggage and stuff weighed down, it's kind of not too. You can't ride it too aggressive off-road. You really just gotta take it easy, and just kind of be careful where you're going with this. Like, I've seen DRs on YouTube. They really tearing up the off-road, you know, but that's like pretty much in the bare configuration, you know. And but it was just with a couple slight mods, it's a good bike. It'll do most of the off-road stuff. Take it to some pretty gnarly places. I would not hesitate. Well, I would hesitate to take it to some gnarly places, but I know what this bike is capable of. And yeah, but it's more of an adventure touring bike. I'm actually planning to get a dirt bike so I can just have more fun off-road, you know. Because you know, I definitely don't want to pick this up after I drop it. It's no fun picking a bike up this heavy. Just in case you're wondering, I think the DR is in like it's in the 400-pound category, somewhere in the 400s. Now, with all the accessories I have on this bike, I'm guessing I'm tipping the scales around 500, probably 500 plus. So, and then me on it, I'm not that heavy a rider, but yeah. So here it is. This is my ride, Hades Omega Moto DR650. It's great fun. The DR650, I highly recommend it. I wish Suzuki would kind of update the design a little bit. It's been 96. They still have the same model, and not much has changed. Not much at all. I wish they would put a sixth gear on it, so you wouldn't have to gear it down. I wish, yeah. In fact, if it just had a six-speed transmission, I think that would solve most of the problems, most of my gripes about this bike. It would be smoother on the freeway. You not have to rev the balls out of it, so that would solve that vibration problem. And two, it would have tighter gearing for the off-road. So Suzuki, if you're watching this video, we want a sixth gear. We want a sixth gear. But the DR Suzuki DR650, great value for money, you know. Just kinda, I would like to try a, what is it, a Yamaha WR250R, but it's just they're just too damn expensive, you know. I bought this. Oh, I never going over how much I bought this for. I bought this for $1,200. $1,200. It ran. It had a couple mods on it. It wasn't very well taken care of. I had to fix some things here and there, but. For $1,200, what a bargain. And I see these go, I think you can get a brand new one for about 5,000, brand new. And you see these go used anywhere from like 2,000 to maybe 4,000, depending on what kind of accessories are on it already. Some people got some pretty, you know, beefy suspension on it. I guess got some fairly basic suspension modifications. Some people go all out on these, and especially even with the forks, you know, they changed the whole front end. But yeah, you can't beat the value on a DR650. And if you're pretty handy with you know, accessorizing the bike, you know, it's even better, you know. Value for money, DR650.